A 46-year-old male, who's been featured on the channel before, is hoping to replace a missing molar with a dental implant. Check out the full workup and surgery today on the Open Reduction. Welcome to the Open Reduction, your channel covering all topics oral and maxillofacial surgery. I'm Dr. Tom Bolten, and today we are performing an internal sinus lift and placing a dental implant in the left maxillary molar site, tooth number 14. This is actually part two of the treatment of this patient. I originally posted the full extraction and bone graft surgery video several months ago. The area has healed and it's time for a dental implant workup. I took a cone beam CT and I'm very happy as to how well the graft preserved the alveolar bone width. However, his sinus is somewhat pneumatized and there's not adequate height to place an implant the size that I want. Remember, socket preservation in this area is chiefly to preserve alveolar bone width and height. The graft will not elevate a low-hanging sinus. I could place an 8mm height implant here, but this is a maxillary first molar. There is a reason this is the biggest tooth in the dentition. It handles substantial forces. I need a large implant here to handle the forces placed on this crown. My plan is to put in an appropriately sized dental implant using an internal sinus lift to get the bone height that I need. This procedure is performed in the office under local anesthesia and nitrous oxide. Once the patient is numb, I make a crestal incision and expose the bone. Next, I use a twist drill to begin the osteotomy. If you are a provider, check out my website, theopenreduction.com, where I have a detailed video series on how to perform sinus lift surgeries exactly like this one. The lesson is a deep dive into sinus lift procedures, covering indications for various sinus lift surgeries, anatomy, complication management, surgical technique, and in-depth step-by-step instructions to perform internal and external sinus lifts. The Open Reduction is an American Dental Association continuing education recognized provider. This lesson, along with others on the website, helps students, general dentists, residents, and dental specialists improve their clinical knowledge and skills in surgical procedures, all while earning CE credit that can be used towards license renewal. Now that the bone is prepped to the depth that I want, I begin to elevate the sinus using bone graft material and osteotomes. The great thing about osteotomes is not only do they elevate the membrane, they also condense the lateral walls of the osteotomy, so the implant is engaging in more compact bone. The posterior maxilla is the least dense tooth-supporting bone, so this compaction is very helpful for implant stability.
Good. Remember that time your kids trashed my basement with that styrofoam?
Finally, I placed the implant. The handpiece torques out well before the implant is fully seated, which is great. This means I will have excellent primary stability. I hand torque the implant to the depth that I want, and then place a cover screw. Finally, I close the site primarily. Here are the post-op images, and I'm very happy with how everything looks. The implant is in a perfect position, and there's no fluid within the sinus, which is a very encouraging sign that there is no perforation of the membrane. I saw this patient back 2 weeks later and removed the sutures. The final step with me is uncovering this implant 4 months from now, at which point he'll go back to his general dentist's office for crown fabrication. Thanks so much for watching. Please click those like and subscribe buttons and check out my channel for additional interesting oral surgery cases like this one. Also, remember to visit my website to get clinically beneficial continuing education credit. I'm Dr. Tom Bolton. I'll catch you next time on the Open Reduction.